New math is whipping motherfuckers ass. You wanna know how to rhyme, you better learn how to add. It's mathematics.
Mighty most definitely.
It's simple mathematics. Check it out. I'll revolve around science.
What are we talking about here?
2 minutes to Paul Scott here with me, and you know, we want to present just some information and then have a discussion about critical race theory. I know it's been heavy in the news. A lot of bills have been written up here in the past couple of months that are considered anti-critical race theory bills. And we just kind of want to add on and make sure that we do what we can to educate the people and let them know what's going on. So I appreciate you for coming on, brother.
We say all praises be to the Creator, all power to his people. In the name of Yahshua, the Black Revolutionary Messiah, I greet you, my brothers and sisters, in the spirit of truth and the words of peace. Shalom aleikum. How you doing, good brother?
I'm great, brother. Thank you for coming on, G.
It's an honor. It's my honor, brother.
Man, I appreciate it. I really appreciate it, man. So I want to start from the beginning. You know what I mean? I pulled up what the Britannica definition of critical race theory is, and I'm going to read it. And it says, the intellectual movement and loosely organized framework of legal analysis based on the premise that race is not a natural, biologically grounded feature of physically distinct subgroups of human beings, but a socially constructed category that is used to oppress and exploit people of color. Critical race theorists hold that law and legal institutions in the United States are inherently racist insofar as they function to create and maintain a social, economic, political, and political inequalities between whites and non-whites, especially African Americans. Now, two things stand out in this. And so one is, they speak as if the race is not a construct that was created by Europeans to justify slavery and the treatment of non-white people all over the world. Mm-hmm. Like, we were always been a tribal people, but before the European, we weren't looking at ourselves as Black people, because we have to remember the whole world is brown. These are the only people that look like that. You know what I'm saying? And so but that's not as important as the part where it says critical race theorists hold that the law and legal institutions in the United States are inherently racist. Like, we know this, right? We know this to be true. We know this to be a fact. But we also have, and this just made me think of something. We've also had our president and vice president in the past month or two, you know, both come out and say that America is not a racist country, right? In the same month that they had to create an anti-Asian hate bill, right? Like, but they said that you know, America's not a racist country. So to me, anti-critical race theorists seem to be just people who want to deny the true history of the world, the true history of original people, and to deny the inherent racism that we see every day within all the institutions of America and Europe. You know what I'm saying? So add on to that, brother. What do you, as far as that definition, do you think it's spot on?
Yeah, to a large degree. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a good white definition.
Yeah.
That's a good white definition. Another, this is a good book called Words That Wound.
Mm-hmm.
Gives a couple of definitions. But what we have to do, brother, mm-hmm. is we have to give a Black definition. Mm. And I like the way you broke that down. You brought out the contradictions.
Right.
We give an African-centered definition, because if you can remember, Karl Marx mm-hmm. didn't mess with race.
Right.
So when these right-wingers, MAGA maniacs, mm-hmm. are saying it's Marxist,
mm-hmm.
and racist, and it blames white people, Karl Marx did not deal with race. He said, workers of the world unite. Yes. And that is the main problem that Black nationalists like Garvey had with socialism and its political manifestation, which is communism.
Right.
It didn't deal with race. It's discounted race. It tried to get race out the way. So a lot of these right wingers, Black and white, have no idea what race, critical race theory is. They're just parroting something that came from the Heritage Foundation, John Locke Foundation, the Manhattan Institute, and all these other think tanks who are pushing this anti-Black agenda under anti-racism. Now, my definition, from an African-centered point of view, I use two books to come up with a definition or a foundation. Neelie Fuller's book, you know, the short version, the code. Yeah, Neelie Fuller's book, indeed, the code book. And also Dr. Francis Cress Wilson's book, The ISIS Papers.
Indeed, indeed.
They both are saying the same thing. Dr. Francis Cress Wilson just gives more psychological examples.
Right. Now,
Neelie Fuller, Brother Neelie Fuller taught us that the only, if you do not understand racism,
Nothing else makes sense to you.
Exactly. Everything else will only confuse you. He followed that up to make it clear.
Right.
The only form of racism that exists in the known universe is white supremacy.
Right.
That has to be our foundation.
Right.
Because they will, if we just go by the definition that's in this book and the one you read about what critical race theory is, they have us fight for everything.
Right, right.
EQ rights, save the whales, save the puppies, save the trees. If we do not Africanize it, both sides are going to either marginalize us or attack us. And we'll totally be left out the conversation.
Right. Real talk. Real talk. And that's a, I'm glad you brought up ISIS papers with that, because I didn't make the connection before, but that book definitely is founded in what we would consider critical race theory, because it breaks down the psychological reasons for why they, you know, for the reason for white supremacy and white domination throughout the world. And so, yeah, that's a great point. And so those, I kind of like to, you know, take it from knowledge to born, from the beginning to the end. So you mentioned some of these think tanks, right, that are behind some of this. Can you just build on like who, like, you know, who some of those think tanks are, and like who, you know, like what is their duty? What have they been doing? Are they put together to put out propaganda like this, or like, you know what I mean? Because I haven't heard, I've heard of the Heritage Foundation, but I don't really know much about them.
This book is readily available. Dr. Asa Hilliard told us to read this book,
okay.
The Power of Ideas by Lee Edwards.
Okay.
It will give you a good outline of the Heritage Foundation.
Okay.
The Heritage Foundation is the right major right-wing think tank.
Okay.
They hire folks to sit around and think all day to develop talking points. So when you see the right-wingers come up with these talking points, they repeat them over and over again. That's the work of the Heritage Foundation.
Right.
They also put out white papers. And we're talking about Heritage Foundation, John Locke Foundation, Manhattan Institute, all these ALEC, another one called ALEC. They put out white papers, and what white papers are, there are agendas that they send out to the media, politicians, and basically the media and politicians. So when you see a news story about critical race theory, they're probably reading on from a white paper that was given to them by the Heritage Foundation.
Wow.
Foundation, which was built on CORE's money. CORE's, the beer.
Yeah, that's the out there in, like, they are the diamonds and the mines right out there in South Africa, huh?
No, CORE's, the beer.
CORE's.
Yeah, CORE's.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah.
It's another book called Citizen CORE's.
Mm-hmm.
and it gives that breakdown as well.
Damn.
But all these foundations, you will be surprised about who actually funds them.
Mm-hmm.
They're just last week, a group started, and they're actually going to be funding school board candidates across the country. And they mentioned North Carolina.
Oh, wow. Okay. Mm-hmm. Can build on that some. Like, what are they funding? Like, all right, so once they fund the school, does that mean that they have some control of the curriculum?
They're funding the candidates.
Oh, okay. Okay.
They're funding the candidates. And I'm sure in many ways they're funding schools as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, there are ways you can do that. Right. Donations. If you look at what the North Carolina Holocaust Council does, they give their information to school systems, curriculums to the school system. So there are ways that they can do that legally.
So,
but
great. I didn't mean to cut your wisdom, G. You just, when you mentioned North Carolina Holocaust Council, are they the ones that were originally, you know, I guess, started the push for the Holocaust education bill in North Carolina?
Yeah, they were the ones that were behind that. And that's what really led me to this point about critical race theory, because critical race theory wasn't on my radar at all.
Mm, right.
But in Charlotte, North Carolina, when I was researching getting Black history added to the Holocaust bill, there was a teacher in Charlotte, and she did a lesson, allegedly, that compared slavery to the Holocaust, even though we know there's no comparison.
Right.
They're talking about millions and millions of African people. That's another story.
And having a culture, language, and everything ripped away from.
Indeed. Indeed. James Baldwin talked about that. But she did the lesson. A parent snitched on her.
Mm-hmm.
And the right-wing websites just pounced on her. All at once.
Oh, I remember this. Uh-huh. Yep, I remember this.
Pounced on her all at one time. And I wrote that in my article in the final call, pulling the sheets off of the academic onslaught. They pounced on her all at one time. So that caught my attention, because I'm like, why are all these websites jumping on this lady? So I saw the tie-in between the people who were behind pushing the Holocaust bill and the people who are fighting against critical race theory. That's what brought me into the fight against critical race theory, because I saw the same people attacking her that were attacking critical race theory.
Right. So for those that don't know, let's kind of go into the whole situation with the Holocaust education bill. And because a lot of people aren't aware of it, just due to the fact that it was in North Carolina and not a federal thing like across the entire nation, but it's setting a precedent for other states to fall in line, because I'm starting to see certain things in Texas as far as quote unquote anti-critical race theory bills. And so I want to start from the beginning. So with the Holocaust education bill, all we were doing, for those who don't know, was simply striving to get a politician in North Carolina to add Black history to the Holocaust education bill. We didn't have a problem with the Holocaust education bill. We said we need to add Black history and tell everybody what happened after that.
Well, after that, really nothing happened. It went to the education committee.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you and a couple other brothers and sisters, one night we got on Twitter, because you are an integral part of this situation. We got on Twitter and we started tweeting North Carolina politicians.
Yeah.
And we got them to take a definite stand to add Black history. You wouldn't let up.
Right.
Until they took a definite stand. So when it went to the education committee, a sister stood up. And she made the motion that Black history would be added. Now, the education committee of the North Carolina House of Representatives, they took a voice vote. And that's when you say yay or nay. And according to the News and Observer, they won by a narrow margin.
Mm.
Now, who's to say who wins when it's a narrow margin?
Right.
Besides the chair.
Right.
So that was on March 23rd.
Mm-hmm.
Since March 23rd, the bill didn't go anywhere.
Mm.
It was supposed to go to the Appropriations Committee,
mm-hmm.
but it just got there and stalled. If you ever seen that Schoolhouse Rock old school joint, I'm just a bill.
Yeah.
Bill. That's what happened. So I'm thinking that because we raised the issue, they had just rather let the bill die than add Black history to it.
Wow.
Because it has not moved since March 23rd. And the crossover date where bills really don't have a chance if they haven't crossed from the House to the Senate, that's already passed.
Right. And well, you know, in that News and Observer article, the part that tripped me out, it said, I forgot which representative said it, but he said something to the effect of, we're already teaching slavery. We didn't say anything about the transatlantic slave trade history bill. We said Black history. You know what I'm saying? And I feel like he purposely said those words. You know what I mean? And, you know, that's a slap in the face to Black people everywhere, especially in North Carolina.
But it's good our people got to see that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because this was a prelude. When they did that, the same board, the same education board that wouldn't let Black history be added, that's the same education board that passed House Bill 324, which mm-hmm. is called it's North Carolina's anti-critical race theory bill. Mm-hmm. It was the same board who passed it.
What was the bill? What was that bill?
House Bill 324.
Okay.
North Carolina House Bill 324.
Because in Texas,
people involved.
Mm-hmm. Hold on, and I want to look up the exact bill so people can follow along whenever they.
And the way they did it, brother, what you're going to have to do is look under the I think the fourth version that was submitted.
Okay.
Because what they did was.
Mm-hmm.
They took a bill about charter schools.
Mm-hmm.
They took a bill about charter schools,
mm-hmm.
killed that bill, carved it up, and snuck an anti-critical race mm-hmm. theory on Friday.
Yeah. Right, right.
By Tuesday, it went to the Education Committee.
Mm-hmm.
By that third Wednesday or Thursday, it already passed the House.
Right, right. Wow. And
you're talking about wickedly wise people, brother.
Yeah. To know, I mean, I just looked it up, God, and so Oklahoma, Texas, North Carolina, there, all of these anti-critical race theory bills coming out at one time all over the country.
Multiple
all at
bills.
The same time.
Multiple, and it's all Heritage Foundation,
right?
Alec, Manhattan Institute, a lot of, and they're all on cold. They're all on code, brother. All these different bills are coming out and they're worded differently, but they all have the same talking points.
Yeah, I was looking for a book there. And so what it's funny, what came up is also, and you're right, like to throw the words communism and Marxism in there as buzzwords to scare people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they're doing.
Yeah, like McCarthyism, the Red Scare back in, the 1920s?
Mm-hmm.
1930s, when they went after anybody, 1950s, when they went after anybody like Paul Robeson and other people and called them communists. It's the same thing. It's the same mentality, the same people.
Yeah, they had There were in that time there was a workers' union that a lot of Black people were involved in, the IWW, the International Workers of the World. Mm-hmm. And they had people like Hubert Harrison, who people don't know about him, you know, that's a great, great brother right here. But and the African Blood Brothers, but they were obviously Marxism and socialism is big on the the science of the proletariat and workers' rights, and they understood that if you could not, nobody was free until you solved the race problem, right? I think it Mark Lamont Hill's channel. He has a channel where he interviews a lot of people. He was interviewing a black dude. He was a Republican and Republican politician, but you know, he was already, he wasn't on our side. He wasn't one of us, right? And I saw his interview, and I saw another interview with a so-called white scholar. And when they asked them though about what critical race theory was, they had no idea. They couldn't articulate it. They really had no idea. And so that just goes to show like what you were saying, they get these like the Heritage Foundation and whoever else is behind these things will send them these buzzwords and say this is what we're on now, and they follow suit and they don't even bother educating. A lot of them don't even bother educating themselves on the so-called the movement or whatever they have that they're pushing, the agenda that they're pushing. It's kind of crazy.
What did Napoleon say? History is an agreed upon lie. History is an agreed upon lie. So they are coded. They're on code, so to speak, with ignorance, with their ignorance. And they can because they're organized. They're organized. Now, that white dude that was on Dr. Mark Lamont's Hill program you spoke about, he's actually the head of the Manhattan Institute. He's the top dog.
Is that the same one that was like when Mark was asked him, so what do you see the benefits of in being white?
He's the top dog pushing the anti-critical race theory movement. How weak his argument was.
Right. And so do you think it's a coincidence? You know, I don't necessarily believe in coincidences, but I believe it was Kamala Harris and somebody else around the same time, came out and said America is not a racist country, because it seems like it's all calculated, because that is in essence what anti-critical race theory is to say that America is not inherently racist and its institutions aren't inherently racist.
Well, critical race theory says it is inherently racist.
Well, yeah, I'm saying anti-critical race theory.
Oh, yeah. That's their thing. And, we can't forget that the main person pushing the anti-critical race theory mob in North Carolina is the Lieutenant Governor, Mark Robinson. He's black.
Yeah, why? Wow, man. Yeah. All skin folk ain't kinfolk.
And he's proudly right wing. Mm-hmm. But that's why we're dealing with going back to Nellie Fuller. We're not dealing with emotion. We're dealing with the idea. The idea, the truth. Now, what they don't like about critical race theory, and if they understand, but they don't know enough about it to really understand it.
Right.
The problem they have with critical race theory is dialectical materialism. Dialectical materialism. That is bringing out the contradictions. I think it was Marx, but I heard the Huey P. Newton Black Panther version of it.
I think that is a Marxist. But go ahead, finish, God. Yeah.
No problem. But the seeds of capitalism, the seeds to the destruction of capitalism lies within its own contradictions.
Right.
Kwame Nkrumah also talks about it. And one of the examples that's given about dialectical materialism is even if you have something like a table, it appears to be solid, but they're actually atoms fighting against each other inside solid material. So the key is if you expose these contradictions, whatever you're fighting against will collapse. That's what fears them, but they don't even know enough about critical race theory to know that's what they're against.
Right. And
so I put it this way. I just do, when I'm dealing with them, if they want to ask me to explain critical race theory, I get my Huey Freeman boondocks.
All right.
Christopher Columbus didn't discover America.
For sure.
Lincoln didn't free the slaves. Mm-hmm. And Jesus was black. Right. That's my favorite.
You know what, G? We were building on the other day about, you know, how we, like if we're online engaging in these conversations with people that are pushing anti-critical race theory, and how you ask them, so what book you read about that? Right, it shuts them up every time, every single time, because they are uninformed. They, and I find that that works when it comes to any topic in regards to Black people. So I want to pull out a few things for people that are watching that I think would help them to understand, because, you know, when we're dealing with critical race theory, we're also dealing with understanding certain some of the institutions. Within critical race theory. So this is definitely one I think everybody should read if they haven't read it, which is The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander, because she's showing and proving with the justice system is full of shit.
But not only that, the reason why that book is important is because nobody's talking about how critical race theory and this whole battle is going to affect Black children.
Right.
What happens when after they pass that law and Tyrone raises his hand and asks that Christopher Columbus question? You know, we already have a problem with our children dropping out and the prison industrial complex. I mean, the school to prison pipeline, the prison industrial complex, school to prison pipeline. That's just going to exacerbate the problem when you pass this law.
No, you're right. And I had a, I experienced that myself at Durham Tech, man. And, you know, I wrote a paper and it was about Black politics in America at that time. And it was dope because I could tell by the reaction of the people that was in there, except for the professor didn't think so. And it just kind of it kind of made me not really care too much about what was going on at Durham Tech anymore, because you're young and you're like, okay, so this not helping me any. And so I can imagine a middle schooler or a high schooler who is, you know, wanting to find his place and wanting to find his identity, and then getting fed whitewashed history that, like, some of those anti-critical race theory bills, like, they are, like, really on some, like, we're not even going to tell you the whole, like when it comes to slavery, we're not even going to tell you the whole truth of slavery. It's like it's wild, God. And I mean, you know, it's definitely a battlefield, and we need everybody on all fronts. And so I also want to show a few Wretched of the Earth,
indeed,
Friends for None, Black Skin, White Mask, Friends for None, The Destruction of Black Civilization,
right,
Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And there's a lot more, but I felt like those, and even in a sense, the autobiography of Malcolm, right? Because
indeed,
you'll see a lot.
Because that's going to tell them the impact of when he was in the eighth grade, what happened to him when he told the teacher he wanted to be what? A lawyer or something?
Yeah. And she said, what did she do? She said, that's not a good occupation for a Negro or something like that.
So I got some books too, brother, that because we have to pull out these books. This is all awesome. And we really only need one to push them to flight.
Oh, yeah. Walter Rodney.
How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney. The reason why this one's important, yes, sir, is because one of the talking points that they use is, well, your own people enslaved Black people.
Yeah, they love using that.
Walter Rodney teaches us that the slavery that existed in Europe was no different than the European feudalism that period. It's a distinction between chattel slavery and the slavery that our African ancestors practiced. It's a difference. Right. One was basically the what they call slaves are really prisoners of war. And they could, after a certain number of years, they could actually become free and they could marry into their enslaved family.
Right. Did you ever read that book of that? There was a the narrative of I don't know if I'm saying his name right, but Olata Equiano.
I've seen the book, haven't read it, brother.
So he was a quote unquote slave in Africa, but also in America during chattel slavery, and he said the difference is night and day, right? And it wasn't he didn't even look at it like it was slavery, like, you know what I mean, in Africa compared to what he went through and the horrors that he saw, during chattel slavery. And that's from the man's own words, somebody who experienced both, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because they try to have this false equivalency that if they're Black races, they gotta be white race. I mean, if they're white races, they gotta be Black races. Mm-hmm. That's just like saying for every white billionaire, there has to be a Black billionaire. It doesn't work.
Right.
But also Forced into Glory, Lerone Bennett.
Okay.
This breaks down the whole myth of Abraham Lincoln freeing the quote unquote slaves.
Right.
Did Christopher Columbus discover America?
Right. That's the one that hits them the hardest. Because that's, I mean, that he's a, we have a, he's a hero to them. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm.
And, you know, of course, Chikanta Drop.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And also, a non-emotional look at slavery, Capitalism and Slavery by Eric Williams.
Oh, yeah, I need that.
Non-emotional look at slavery. He looks at it from the standpoint of just being business.
Right. Yeah, I gotta get that.
And also another book I have.
If you think about it, it went from feudalism in Europe, and slavery was kind of like the precursor, or like the precursor to capitalism, because that was really the exploitation. Exactly, people being exploited for labor. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, so yeah, that's another thing that one thing that they like to bring out is the Irish were slaves too, and they worked themselves out of the condition that they were in. But that's not true, for one. And second, they benefited from whiteness. Whenever, you know, and that's I just see that as one of the myths that they like to put out there whenever critical race theory and the history of the transatlantic slave trade is being discussed.
But the thing they had in common, mm-hmm. whether they liked each other or not, they hated us. Look at the race riots of the late 19th century, the draft riots in New York around 1865. The Irish hated us. Hated African people, and the one thing they had going for them, Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois talks about it in his book on Black Reconstruction. Even the poorest white person could sleep at night knowing that he was superior to the smartest Black person.
Right.
That's what you have, brother, when you're dealing with critical race theory. The poorest white tobacco chewing, snuff chewing, NASCAR race watching, Dukes of Hazzard watching white person feels he is intellectually superior to the smartest black person with a PhD.
Right. Wow.
And critical race theory busts up that contradiction, and they don't want that to happen. Right. Now, see, they don't even want to get into the conversation about what it is and what it ain't.
Right.
You know, when you're dealing with the European in this country, it's always that implied threat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can challenge them intellectually to a point, but it's always that implied threat that if you push it too far, we're just going to get the rope.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's always been that way. They always have had that organization and that the numbers to say, okay, we're going to give you a look, an appearance of freedom. But if you push it too far, even the most liberal of us, we're going to get that rope.
Mm-hmm. Right. You know what I was just thinking too, brother? This is really being pushed it's like a 52 fake out situation going on. We have all this stuff going on in the news. They're pushing all these bills nationwide. We looking this way, and they over there doing what they do. Meaning most black people in America aren't aware that this is happening right now. And we have to continue to, you know, pound it and keep, you know, bringing it to the forefront, because it's people got to understand this is not just critical race theory as a theory, it's critical race theory as a practice, because they are anti-critical race theory as a practice, because they are putting bills together where they're going to, you know, stop teaching the truth as if they were teaching the truth anyway. You know what I'm saying?
Go ahead, brother.
No, you're good.
And I'm not taking anything away from the people who were doing the marching and protesting. If that's your thing, that's your thing.
Mm-hmm.
But while we were doing that, and we wondered where all the white people were, remember? We wondered where the conservatives went.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they didn't show up till January 6th. Mm-hmm. January 6th is really what's fueling the anti-critical race theory.
Mm-hmm.
The same senators who just voted against having a commission, a January 6th commission, to look at the riot that the conservatives did at the Capitol. Same people pushing critical race theory.
Wow.
It's the same people. But while our people were out there marching and looking at the protests, they were affecting legislation. That's where they were.
Right.
They were affecting legislation. They went back to their think tanks. Their think tanks started saying, okay, I even saw one of them on Fox saying, our battle's going to be at the school board.
Mm, wow.
But I did send a letter to the school, Durham School Board, the day before their school board meeting, and asked them to draft a resolution against House Bill 324. And they did that to a degree. They threw some other stuff in it, but they did it. Now they drafted it, but they're supposed to vote on it at the end of June.
Okay, so for people like that are, you know, going to be tuning in, and you have these different bills popping up in, you know, different states all across the nation, and even if they haven't, they will be. What can people do, you know, to, bring this kind of stuff to light, put pressure on politicians? What do we need to do?
Like Kwame Ture taught us, organize. Political education. See, one of the things that we don't do, we get out there and say, go vote. But we don't want to give our people political education. This is going to take political education.
Mm-hmm.
We have to explain, first of all, what critical race theory is.
Right.
From an African Senate point of view.
Mm-hmm.
And from an African Senate point of view, we just make it plain to the people. They don't want our children to learn about Black history. That's all you got.
Right.
as it gets. Right. You ain't got to go into dialectical materialism and all these other factors of critical race theory. Just make it plain for the people. They don't want, they're going to make it illegal to teach Black history, which is basically what it will do.
Yeah.
Also, all politics is local.
Right.
All politics
is local. All politics is local. Okay.
Wherever city you're in, fight against it. Engage your school board. Have your local school board draft a resolution like I did. We did in Durham. A few of us did in Durham. We got together. We made it happen. We asked them to do anything. The city council is supposed to do one. They said they were going to draft a bill, so we'll see. But and get engaged with your local school board and your state school boards, because this is where the battle is going to take place. So we have to educate, mobilize, and we have to push the politicians to move against whatever bill in your state that they have against critical race theory. Because in North Carolina, actually, brother, they already had two bills out there.
Wow.
They snuck the bill. See, they faked me out, bro, because as you know, on social media, I don't sleep.
Right.
I'm looking at 1 o'clock. I get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, look again. I get up at 7 o'clock in the morning, make sure I don't miss it. So if they could sneak that bill behind, around me, man, they could sneak it around anybody. But they had two other bills in the Senate that were their critical race theory bills. And those got exposed like the day, 2 days before.
Wow, okay.
2 days before they did the fake out, they exposed, I think it was Senate Bill 700, which was supposed to be one of their two critical race theory bills. That got exposed, and it just out of the blue, out of nowhere, came up with another one and just ran that home.
Right. So that shows you how determined they are to get it through.
The determined idea.
Yep. You already know. I definitely feel like this is more important than a lot of people realize, which is the reason why I wanted to have this discussion. I wanted to show some books that dealt with it. I also wanted to build with you about things that we could do. And I remember that you, something that you told me that I found, it just made a whole lot of sense, is especially when we're engaging with politicians on social media. If we can get them to commit to say yes or no, we have something on record. Even moving forward, we have this on record from you. So either we're gonna make you out to be a liar, or you're gonna stand by your word. You know what I'm saying?
And you can bear witness. That works.
Right. It definitely works. Yeah.
We saw it firsthand. It works.
Right.
three, 4 hours to 1 o'clock in the morning, but it works.
Right. So for the people in different states, man, all you got to do is just hit a quick Google search to see who your, house reps are. And whenever you find out what the bill is in your state, hit them up on Twitter, ask them what they think about it, and keep badgering them. And they'll eventually answer and get them on record and get them on record.
Because with Facebook, a lot of us use Facebook primarily. And the thing about Facebook is you're dealing with, based on the algorithm, you're dealing with like minds. You're dealing with the same 25, 30 people that you already know, and you're seeing their posts over and over again.
Right.
With Twitter, depending on how you hashtag it, it could be wide open.
Yeah.
And once they respond, it's public record. Also, once you email a politician to their official account, the government account, that's a matter of public record. Because sometimes they'll fake you out and hit you up on Facebook or hit you up on their private email. No, always deal with them with their official government email, because it becomes a matter of public record. What we did was, with the school board, not only did we send letters to the school board through their school board emails, I also sent my letter to the actual public hearing section so it can be read in the record. because I know a lot of times, you know, they're duck and dodge when it comes to Black history. But the thing is, see, we get all frustrated and bent out of shape. Oh, they ain't going to listen to us. Fine. Just make sure what you say is read into the record.
Right.
That's one of the things that the Moors, listen to the Moors. They always stress the value of documentation.
Mm-hmm.
The value of having it read into the record.
Right.
So always make sure what you do is read into the record. Even with activists, even when you come up with the idea, write an article, send a letter to the editor, make sure your idea is documented somewhere.
Right.
I always do that because, you know, people take your ideas and run with it.
Oh, yeah.
And make sure, one thing I did, side note, and oh, by the way, I did set up a website, AfricanAmericanTruthCommission.com.
African-American Truth Commission. I'm going to link it in the video.
.com. One of the things I noticed about activists, when you have an idea, .com that joint.
Okay.
You can go on GoDaddy.com.
Mm-hmm. Get you a domain. Time,
go on Google and look up GoDaddy.com discount.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Most of the time, you can find a .com that for the first year is anywhere between 99 cents and $5. .com your idea. As soon as you have an idea, sometimes you can get them, they have still 90, first time with a .com is 99 cents for the first year. Second year is going to run you $18.
Right.
At the highest.
Right.
But immediately, anytime you have an idea, .com it, because most people, they got .org, .net, but most people are familiar with .com. So once you .com your idea, nobody can touch it.
Why is it important for activists to copyright their stuff or you trademark their stuff?
Because people, that's to me is a poor man's trademark.
Yeah, yeah.
People in my economic condition, you know, I don't have the $400.
Right.
Although right. Sometimes it probably is worth the investment.
Mm-hmm.
But the poor man trademark would be just .com it. And it's important because you own that name because even though you did not spend the $400 to incorporate it or trademark it, they can't do a .com. They can't do AfricanAmericanTruthCommission.com. They can't do that because if they even would take the name, they can't do a .com website.
Right, right.
If they did do a AfricanAmericanTruthCommission.org or .net or whatever, that would still drive energy back to the .com.
Yeah.
And you can also, even when you get a .com, you can also get a .net, .org.
Because I bought a few domains too and I did that as well.
Like, you know, and they'll say if you want an extra domain, it's like $1 or $2. Mm-hmm. You can actually get all the domains probably for about, what, $20?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. So, why now? Why are they coming out with, I mean, because we've been teaching and brothers and sisters have been writing about institutional racism, I mean, since slavery, during slavery, right? Why now? Why are politicians hell-bent now on putting out all these anti-critical race theory bills?
I think it had a lot to do with the previous administration. While we got caught up in the emotionalism and we thought we beat them, they were just hunkering down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we thought we beat them because Biden and Kamala Harris became president. No, they just took it to another level.
Right.
They used that anger to mobilize. You know, and I use we loosely. I know not you, but the majority of us, you know, we protest, we march, we yell, we curse. You know, people get out in the protest, start twerking, and
that was wild, man.
And that's you wonder, and you think you done scared these conservatives, you know, because you don't see them. And you know, well, you know, we were out there; they didn't show up. Nah, they went to their politicians, and they began to mobilize their people behind the scenes. So all of a sudden, like you said, good brother, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the attack on critical race theory just popped up after January 6th.
Right. Wow.
After January 6th, it just popped. If you go on Twitter right now and do a search under critical race theory, man, that thing since the last month, it's been almost trending every night, critical race theory.
All the protests and while they were, you know, getting this kind of thing together, getting ready to push legislation through or create an agenda to an anti-critical race theory. It's kind of, and we talked about Black Lives Matter the last time you came through, and I found it interesting that all that marching, all of that singing, all of that Black Lives Matter was doing, all that performative stuff, and now the co-founder is stepping down and pursuing a career in Hollywood and signed a deal with Warner Brothers while this is going on.
Indeed, and plus the George Floyd bill has yet to be passed.
Oh yeah, they said that we'll have a conversation.
All that legislate, all that marching with no legislation.
Yep, with none. But so I did look it up.
Race theory is being passed in all these states though.
I just did. It is everywhere. I mean, what is good is there are a lot of brothers and sisters out here. I just typed it in, like this sister, Amani Perry, she just tweeted out, it had like 4,000 likes, 89 tweets. Has anyone put together a thread of key critical race theory books? So people are out here fighting it, you know what I'm saying?
To a degree,
right?
But can I add on to that right quick, brother?
Yeah, for sure.
How can I put, I don't have to be politically correct. I'm blacklisted anyway.
Yeah.
We can't let this conversation just be amongst the intelligentsia,
mm-hmm.
the academic
mm-hmm.
conversation, mm-hmm. because they will keep it locked in. When you're dealing with the Nicole,
they're not going to do nothing. They're going to talk about it all day.
Well, they'll do something. They get professorships. Even when you're dealing with the Nicole Hannah Jones,
mm-hmm.
Who put together the
1619 project, and I saw what's going on with her at Carolina.
Mm-hmm. She was for those who aren't aware, in North Carolina, and I told y'all North Carolina. I told when I did your show back in February, I said North Carolina is a battleground.
Yep, it is.
They refused to give her tenure at UNC. She got a new job at UNC. They refused to give her tenure. But we can't allow the conversation to be amongst the intelligentsia.
Yes, I agree.
I'm fighting for the liberation of Black people, the masses of our people. I'm a Garveyite. I'm dealing with the masses. I'm not dealing with the talented 10th intelligentsia.
Right.
I'm dealing with the masses. They will keep the whole conversation amongst themselves, not caring about the Black children,
mm-hmm.
not caring about the Black parents. And the whole conversation becomes about professors getting tenureship.
Yep. What were your thoughts on that whole situation with Nicole Hannah Jones? First, did you like the 1619 Project?
I haven't read the whole thing because, you know, the conservatives, they are finding flaw. They have this one flaw that they parry. And this had to come from, let me give you another think tank.
And hold on, I don't want to cut.
United.
What was the name of it?
1776 United.
That's what I was going to say. That's what I was going to say. The 1619 Project came out. It seems like that may be the beginning of when they started formulating their plan for this anti-critical race theory movement. Because I remember seeing how mad they were, how it became a political issue. Then they even came up, I don't know if they ever put it out, but there were rumblings that they were going to put out the 1776 Project.
It's out there. It's called 1776 United. It's Woodard Foundation. Bob Woodard. If you remember back in the, for those of us who were older, back in the 90s, mid-90s, when Tavis Smiley and them had their talk shows on TV, they used to always bring these Black conservatives on. Bob Woodard, Robert Woodard, was one of those Black conservatives that they would bring on. He's the one running with Glenn Beck right now. He's one of the poster children for the anti-critical race theory movement. So when you see the 1776 United, and it's online too, 1776 United, scroll to the bottom and research the Woodard Foundation.
Okay.
Woodward Foundation. Bob Woodward. But they are organizing, brother. There are a lot of foundations, a lot of groups. Again, going back to the idea of the intelligentsia.
They got open white supremacist symbolism all throughout this page.
You seem surprised, brother. The reason why the right wing, they're winning, it's because they're connected to their stormtroopers.
Yeah.
They're connected to the foot soldiers. The Black intelligentsia, they ain't connected to the grassroots. That's why they're having a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
But the everyday mother and father who have children in the school system, they would totally leave them out the conversation. And again, they make it all about getting a job at a white university. If we let them. If we let them.
Great point, man. Great point. This is a important issue that we all need to get behind. And I appreciate you for coming through, because I think even whenever you brought, I've been seeing it in the news, I've been seeing it online, but whenever you brought it to me, and I started researching more of my own, I was like, wow, they're actually putting legislation behind this. You know what I'm saying? So I think this conversation was needed. Before we go though, is there anything else like on critical race theory that you think the people should know of, as far as like how to combat it, what it is, what we need to do, books to read, or anything?
We have to organize. And more importantly, the most important thing, we have to make it relevant to the people.
Yes.
The masses of our people are totally, our mission, our main mission right now has to be to make it relevant to the people. And like I said earlier, the way to make it relevant to the people is just to tell the average person on the bus, at the water cooler, walking down the street, brother and sister, they're trying to make teaching Black history legal.
Mm.
And then, we can have further conversations. Then we develop, work on the books, the works of Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, Nellie Fuller, and then we turn it into a full-blown conversation about Black history.
Indeed. And I'm not with the intellectual elitism that a lot of our people in certain positions display. But at the same time, the people, the masses, we need to make it to where they are educated on these things as well. And people have it twisted because they think that a lot of our people don't read when they actually do. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they just might not be familiar with what to read. You know what I'm saying? And so we got to keep putting these works out here in the forefront so our people can get hip to it if they're not already. You know what I'm saying? Because the more we know, the better we are prepared to fight. You know what I'm saying? And that our people that came before us already put in the work as far as these books and these articles that we hold dear to us. So I definitely wanted to highlight those.
And you don't have to use 1619. Use Hidden Colors. Mm. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Use Hidden Colors. Use the lectures of Dr. John Henry Clark. That could be, we don't have to use 1619. Like I wanted to say, they're using one little thing from 1619. They say, well, what's not factually correct about it? They say something about, well, they said that the Revolutionary War was fought to end slavery, or something like that. That's the only thing they're parroting. Yeah. But we don't have to use the thing you hit them up with. One, have them define critical race theory, which they can't. And two, have them say, okay, we don't have to use 16. We know that you haven't studied 1619 mm-hmm. prior. And mm-hmm. you definitely aren't even aware of our great master teachers.
Right.
So anytime they say complaining about 1619, say, no, we don't have to use that. Let's use hidden colors. Are you familiar with hidden colors?
Right, right. And another thing I want to ask you, and I want you to build on too. We cannot let them turn this into, the liberals are pushing critical race theory. The right. liberals this, the, you know, because this ain't got nothing to do with Republican or Democrat as far as when it comes to Black people.
Indeed, because Malcolm taught about the liberals and the conservatives. Mm-hmm. What did he say? The analogy he used was the fox and the wolf.
Yeah, the fox and the wolf.
Only difference is the fox smiles at you.
Right.
So we have to come up like Dr. Bobby E. Wright taught us in the Psychopathic Racial Personality, that group of essays, we have to develop a Black social theory.
Mm-hmm.
A Black social theory. Critical race theory is just a prop.
Yeah, yeah.
It really, they don't know what it means. It really doesn't mean too much from us besides dialectical materialism.
Mm-hmm.
Also, it could be the equivalent to Black liberation theology. They're not talking about that.
Mm.
When you're talking about critical race theory, you're talking about it's parallel to Black liberation theology. They're not talking about that. But we have to blacken it up. When they start talking about socialism, we got to bring up Dr. Huey P. Newton, Kwame Ture,
C.L.R. James.
Yeah, all those who put it into a Black perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say especially Kwame Ture.
Yes.
He took the concepts of socialism and Marxism and put it into a Black perspective. And that's what we have to do.
For those, it's one of my favorite books from Kwame Ture. For those who want to read more about him, definitely start with that, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, very well said. Now, like I said, I appreciate you for coming through.
Appreciate you, man.
So yeah, we'll, you know, we're going to continue to fight, and anytime we need to get something out, you know what I'm saying? We're going to do it. And again, bro, I appreciate you, man. Cause it's more than just obviously just having a conversation. There's work to be done and it's important work. So, I definitely appreciate everything that you do for the community. Cause you've been doing it for a while I salute you, bro.
I salute you too, brother. My Twitter, if you want more information, hit me up, Truth Minister, that's with an A. Website, blackmessiahmovement.com, and the other website I gave, African American Truth Commission.com. So honored to be on your program, brother. I really enjoyed it. It's much needed. And as always, we leave you with the Black Messiah motto: stop waiting for a savior. And be one.
Already. Peace, brother.
Shalom, brother.